Hello again. I hope we've all enjoyed our break. It is now 4 p.m. in South Africa, and I'm delighted to introduce our next guest speaker. He's an accomplished researcher and practitioner with over 13 years of experience in the construction sector. He holds an MSc in construction management and a BSc in building technology, both earned at the Kwame Nkrumah University of Technology and Science and Technology in Ghana. Currently, he is pursuing a postgraduate degree in construction management at the University of New South Wales in Sydney, Australia. He's an active member of several professional membership bodies, both in Ghana and internationally. He has consulted on numerous projects focused on youth well-being in Ghana and globally. With his extensive experience, he continues to be the driving force in the construction sector, working tirelessly to improve the health and safety practices while creating meaningful impact through his research and collaborations with key stakeholders. So without wasting any further time, please help me welcome Samuel Frimpong, who will be delivering a presentation titled Promoting Mental Health Wellbeing and Inclusivity. Over to you, Samuel.
Thank you, Ntando. Thanks for the introduction. I'm surprised about some of the things I heard about myself. Okay, so as you heard, my topic is promoting students' mental well-being and inclusivity. So he's introduced me already, so I don't need to go into too much of the detail. Now you see a picture on your screen. I'll give you maybe about 15 to 20 seconds of my time to reflect on this picture, and then we'll have a short discussion on this slide before we proceed to the real issues. So let's just assume when you woke up this morning and then you go ready to go to work or school, as you stepped out of the house and turned around the corner, you saw this guy sitting on a lion. What are some of the things that will come to your mind about this guy? Maybe you can type them in the comment section so that I know exactly what you're thinking. Okay, so I have shown this picture to quite a number of people during my presentations at other places. And usually, Asana says terrified. Yes, he is. It's good you spotted it. So usually I get a mixture of responses. I get some people saying, well, he's brave. How does he do that? And then I also get people saying terrified, right? Now, that can be the situation in which you find yourself. As a young person, Kojo says brave. As a young person in the construction industry who is studying, you know, this guy's situation is such that the average human being walking who sees him will think, wow, how did he do that? But when you look at him, he's wondering, how do I prevent this lion from eating me? So, for example, if you find yourself as a woman occupying a key position in a male-dominated industry like the construction industry, well, people could praise you for your achievements. But maybe sometimes deep down, you wonder, how do I prevent this lion from eating me? If you're a young person in school, and then maybe you meet people and then they ask you, what do you do? And you say, I study what course? And you say, maybe architecture, building technology, construction management. They say, wow, those are good courses. After school, there's a lot of jobs for you to do. But then the question you ask is, after school, how do I prevent this lion from eating me? Or perhaps you someone from a minority background, and then you find yourself in a place where everyone else is different from you. Sometimes you could ask yourself, how do I prevent this lion from eating me? And all of this will lead to a lot of stress and sometimes anxiety, which might lead to poor mental health. So that is what we are going to discuss today, mental health and then the issue of inclusivity, right? They are closely related. That is why this topic was chosen. Now, before we start, I want to find out how much you know about mental health and inclusivity. So the first statement, you answer true or false. Good mental health is the absence of mental illness. True or false? I would love to see your comments. Good mental health is the absence of mental illness. True or false? The second one is, anyone can suffer poor mental health at any point in their life. True or false? Third, it is possible to recover from poor mental health. True or false? And then finally, inclusivity is mainly about increasing the number of women in the construction industry and making sure they achieve the same status as men. True or false? Okay, I'm getting a few comments. Okay. So let's go through the answers. Good mental health is the absence of mental illness. The answer is false. Yes. So Kim, you're right. The answer is false. The fact that someone does not have mental illness does not mean that they have good mental health, as we will soon understand. Number two is true. Anyone can suffer poor mental health at any point in their life. So in theory, no human being is perfectly mentally healthy. We all have some aspects of poor mental health, but we are able to function properly. And so when you look at the third one, the answer is true. It is possible to recover from poor mental health. If it gets too excessive, then you can become mentally ill. But almost every human being you see at some point in their life experiences poor mental health. Now the last one. Inclusivity is mainly about increasing the number of women in the construction industry and making sure they achieve the same status as men. That is false. That is false. So let's look at some of the facts. The WHO says mental health is a state of well-being. So this particular expression, well-being, has got to do with feeling good about yourself, feeling that your life is worth living, and feeling that you are able to contribute to your personal progress and that of other people. Once you do that, you will be satisfied with life. So when you are somewhere on this spectrum, you are classified as someone who has good mental health. So it nowhere talks about disease. But unfortunately, mental health has been turned into something that is reflective of disease. So when I was preparing, I just typed types of mental health or aspects of mental health, and then most of the websites returned a list of diseases. That is wrong. The question is that anyone at all can suffer poor mental health at any point, and it is possible to recover. Now, please take note, the last one, inclusivity is about all types of people, not just about women. The construction industry prioritizes the role of women for a reason, but it's about all types of people. And it's not just about ensuring that women become the same as men. We will understand why. Let's move on. So why should you be interested in this topic, the issue of mental well-being, inclusivity? I'm sure you can see that graph on the screen very well. At what point do the lines begin to peak? At what point do they begin to peak? Do you observe that right before someone turns 15, the lines begin to peak all the way up until when they are in early 20s, and then there's a bit of a decline up until 30.5 years. Why is this important? If you're a young person who is taking a course in construction, or even if you're old, I mean, once you find yourself in school, it is highly possible that you will be in this age bracket. And research says that this is the particular age bracket within which most people experience mental health disorders. So this topic has a lot of relevance for you, right? It's something that we want to pay attention to. Now, how do we promote our mental health and well-being? I don't want to go into the disease aspects because it's becoming so much like pervasive. We hear a lot about disease. I'm going to focus on the positive aspects of mental well-being. So simply put, you promote your mental well-being by focusing on positive mental health. You have to try to increase your positive mental health. So what is positive mental health? Well, according to research, there are four dimensions of positive mental health. The first is emotional well-being. This one refers to your personal feelings. So when you have good emotional well-being, you feel good about yourself. The second is your psychological well-being. This means personal progress. So for example, when you get a job promotion or when you write an exam at school and then the results come and you realize that you have done well and you're going to progress to the next stage. Or when you're graduating, that feeling that you get when you realize that the future is bright for you, that is psychological well-being. Social well-being refers to how you're able to contribute to the society, right? Or how you're able to ensure that the society is progressing and then how you feel that you are part of it or not. Then spiritual well-being has got to do with your connection with nature and then the supernatural. So for most people, that will be connection with God, Allah, or if you're a traditionalist, you worship your ancestors, or whatever form of spiritual practice you are engaged in. Now, most people will express this as religion or their connection with the environment. How do we improve emotional well-being? I'll add that to psychological well-being because the two are closely related. Interestingly, the research findings on improving emotional well-being and psychological well-being are not sophisticated. Simply put, we have to be of good behavior. Because these kind of well-being mainly dwell on our personal progress and our personal feelings, when we engage in good behavior, we develop good feelings about ourselves. So some recommendations from researchers suggest that we should stay away from being drunk, abusing drugs, and staying away from anything that could get us arrested. The same with psychological well-being. This time we have to practice things that improve our personal skills. So when you're setting goals, you might be a student of construction, but where do you set your goals? One thing that we all need to understand is that although we might be taking courses in the built environment, when you look at a breakdown of your transcript and when you look at the kind of things that you do at school, you realize that the kind of training you're receiving is not only designed to make you functional in the construction industry. You can function elsewhere, right? And I'm sure you have heard examples from this particular edition of the Student Festival and elsewhere that demonstrate that people who work in construction have multiple skills and are versatile. So when you set goals, don't only set goals that you want to become something in the construction industry. You can become something else. Or when you're setting your academic goals, try and add other goals that are non-academic. Otherwise, when you dwell on just one thing and you struggle to achieve it, everything else will come down with it. How can we improve our social well-being? We do so by engaging in activities that make us develop a sense of contribution to the society. So for all of you here who are going to school or who are young, the CIOB provides many opportunities for you to volunteer. You could join the Tomorrow's Leaders as a champion, or you could become a representative. We have heard that some of the universities have groups. These are groups that have a very high purpose to promote professionalism among young people. When you do these things, after the next 5-10 years, you realize that you have contributed personally to the progress of many people. And those are some of the things that will bring you deep satisfaction. How do you promote spiritual well-being? Well, if you are religious, then you have to be serious about it. The reason is that this one improves social well-being, psychological and emotional well-being. People barely practice their religion alone. They do so as part of a group. And the group takes care of them when they have problems, and they're able to help other people who also have problems. Now, religion also improves the amount of hope that people have. Many people lose their joy or their mental well-being when they lose hope in life. And that is one thing that being spiritual helps you to overcome. Another key aspect, connection with the environment. So when you want to improve your spiritual well-being, improve your environment. It starts with where you live, where you sleep, where you go to school. When you go to the classroom, how is the place like? Do you make the place dirty? How do you feel when the environment is being degraded? Today, the whole world is in turmoil because of the issue of climate change. And instead of just being a scientific issue, it has even become a political issue, a battle of ideologies. And that is all because human beings are failing to take care of the environment. What you see when you watch the news and the debates and then the aggression related to climate change are all symptoms of poor spiritual well-being. We do well to take note of all of these things. Now let's go to promoting inclusivity. So like I mentioned, the spotlight is on the contribution of women to the industry. The construction industry has traditionally and historically been a male-dominated one. Now, we understand that for the industry to become more innovative, we need more people to contribute their ideas. And that is why women are welcome, because we have seen in other industries that women have made a lot of good progress. For example, when you look at the health sector, we can see that women have made very good progress as far as the health sector is concerned. And perhaps one reason why the construction industry is one of the least innovative industries in the world could be that we do not have a lot of women who can introduce new forms of thinking into the industry, right? So wherever you may find yourself, if you want to promote inclusivity, focus on inclusion and assimilation. This is what I mean. Sometimes we see it as just adding people who are different from us to the numbers. So for example, if we are an organization full of men, we just have to add one or two women. Or if we are an organization full of people from Ghana, we just have to get someone from South Africa to add to us, then we can say, oh, it's an inclusive organization. But as we add these people, what do we ensure they get out of the addition? We have to ensure that if there are any systematic inequalities, they are removed. And we have to ensure that they play some of the key roles that the organization needs. That is assimilation, because it will make them feel part of the organization. But there's something that we want to be careful while we are promoting inclusivity. We don't want to overemphasize equality of outcomes. All human beings are different. Even people who come from the same family are very different. So we cannot expect that all of us will achieve the same things, even when we have the same resources and the same opportunities. So when we give it a try, we don't have to push too hard. I've worked on projects where the sole objective of the project was to ensure that all the women who were on that project were going to become entrepreneurs in the construction industry at the end of their training. What we realized was that when the program came to an end, of about the 4,000 women who were part of the program, only about 3 or 4 were able to set up their own businesses and run them. The rest just left off and went to do something else. And the reason? We focus too much on equality of outcomes. The industry is broad. School is broad. We have a lot of roles. Once we bring in minority groups, for example, if we have women, we should allow them to choose whatever they want to do, as far as it fits into their personal goals and plans. And finally, we want to realize inclusivity is not a war on majority groups. Sometimes when you look at the discussions that go on social media, you tend to develop this feeling that the agenda of inclusivity and diversity is turning into something very different. But that will not help the construction industry, right? So whilst you're in school, you have a lot of opportunity to be able to join or to assimilate into minority groups. This is what you do. When I assign students to groups to do assignments, what I notice is that, for example, all the Indians tend to pull into one group, all the Chinese tend to pull into one group, and then all the Australians tend to pull into one group. But when you are in school, these things provide opportunities for you to see the world through other people's eyes. So why not take the opportunity to be able to mix up with other people? And then it's going to help you, because by the time you are out of school and you've gone out to work, you are very sensitive to the needs of other people who are different from you because you have taken the opportunity to work with them before. Okay, so I will not take too much of your time. To end, let's do a 1 minute reflection. You can write down what you want to remember from what you have heard. What do you think needs to change about your view of mental well-being and inclusivity? What role can you play in promoting mental well-being and inclusivity? Just 1 minute reflection. Thank you. If you need further information, it's provided at the end of the slide, which I think will be made available to you sometime after the program.
Thank you, Samuel. I'm still dwelling on the slide where there was a man riding a lion. I think that's my greatest fear. So I don't see myself going that far. But thank you so much for a very insightful and reflective session. I'd now like to just invite our audience to ask us any questions that they have. If it's comments as well, please feel free to just write them on the chat box. I think while we wait, there is a question I'm quite keen to ask you, Samuel. I think as an academic, what role do faculty members or academics play in promoting mental health, and inclusivity in universities?
Okay, so there's emerging research on this question, so I'm very happy that you have asked it. It was found that how teachers are assigned to teach courses and how teachers group students have an impact on this issue of mental health and inclusivity. So for example, in classrooms, females are a bit disoriented because they see that most of the key roles are played by males, and then they cannot see themselves beyond the classroom. And that could be one of the reasons why, although there's an increasing number of females taking courses in the built environment, right after school, they disappear. We don't see where they go, right? So the recommendation now is when we are forming groups, what we have to do is that we either have to mix in males and females to work together, or sometimes one key recommendation that we have gotten from some of the studies is maybe you have 10 groups. Create 9 groups that are male and then create 1 group that is female. Put them together, let them work. And then as the females are able to work together to build results or work that is able to equal that of the males or challenge them to do well, they are able to see that they can also contribute whether they are males or not, right? It's still emerging. And so we are looking to see whether we'll get new insights or not. And the issue of mental health, one thing I have realized from personal experience, anytime I have had the opportunity to mentor students who are struggling, I realize that many of them have chosen the wrong program. That is the bottom line. Built environment courses are very difficult. They are not the type of programs where you can just wait till the last minute and read and go and sit for an exam. You can't, especially if you're doing architecture. You would have to forgo your normal life and then become a slave of the system, right? That is the thing with built environment courses. So what we can do as academics is to perhaps open up the uni. In some of the schools we see they do that, they have an open day or an all week where people who are yet to come to uni are able to come and interact with the staff and students, and then they get to get some good mentoring or counseling. Then they can be able to choose their courses according to their strengths and their personal preferences.
Okay. Thank you so much, Samuel, for that answer. It's very insightful. Is it okay if I just ask you one more question? We do have 1 minute left. We have a question from Rosalind Thorpe. Is there an issue in the West in terms of viewing humans as economic units?
Okay, so interestingly, we had this discussion just last week in one of our classes. So it's a typical problem with, I don't think the West per se, it's a problem with the construction industry. We focus on goals and not on people, right? So typically when you go to the construction site, you have views or you have problems that need to be solved. if helping you becomes an impediment to the project, you'll be replaced by someone else. If you don't come today, the next day someone will take your place, right? So the industry does not really dwell on humans. It dwells on deadlines, outcomes, trying to finish projects. And it's not surprising that of all the factors that cause poor mental health, the most critical, the most significant are workload factors. Factors associated with working for long hours, undertaking complicated tasks, and trying to please your bosses and not having good relationships at work. So it's a typical thing with the construction industry and not the worst per se, as far as my knowledge in the construction industry is concerned.
Okay. Thank you, Samuel. As they say, all good things have to come to an end. I must say your presentation was very engaging and thought-provoking. It captivated our audience and it provided a wealth of knowledge and, I must say, inspiration. And your willingness to share your expertise, has had a profound impact on all our attendees. So I hope you've enjoyed your time with us, and I hope you'll consider joining us again in our future events. And I will now be handing over to my colleague, Hassan Ahmed, for our next session with Sophie Leek. Over to you, Hassan.